This is the NucDeck. It's a handheld gaming PC powered by Nuc Mini PC that I've spent the last 4 months building and documenting here on YouTube. The design is open source so you can contribute or build your own. Today I'm going to finish off the buttons and test the triggers, so let's get started. Let's start off with the positives for the button molds. The shoulder and trigger buttons are a bit bigger than the face buttons, so I'm going to make them separately, but I will do all of the face and top buttons in one mold, so I'll start with that one first. I've loaded up a bit of 8mm thick aluminium and my trusty 4mm double fluted end mill. I don't have a functional coolant system on this machine yet, so I'm just giving the material a spray with a bit of WD-40 occasionally. With sensible feeds and speeds, the tool really only needs a spray every couple of minutes anyway, so it's not too impractical doing it this way. There's lots of different alloys available, but I'm making all of these positives out of 5083, which provides a good combination of machinability and strength. I'll start out by roughing down the stock wherever the 4mm end mill will fit, and then we will move on to the 2mm end mill to do the finer detailed sections around the button locator tabs and the D-pad supports. Luckily, there isn't much machining to do on the tighter sections because you have to feed pretty slow with these smaller cutters when processing aluminium. I'm only feeding the tool at about 300mm a minute for this section as opposed to the roughly 1200mm a minute I can achieve with the larger 4mm end mill. There's a small rebate in the back of the mode select toggle switch, which I need to mill out with a 1mm end mill, which is even slower. Once the finer detailed sections are complete, I can load up the 4mm ball nose and finish the radius on the tops of the ABXY buttons and the dished front of the D-pad. The final step is to engrave the lettering into all the buttons, so I swapped to a macro lens to try and get you guys a nice close-up of the process. The engraver tip I'm using is roughly 0.1mm wide and tapers up to 4mm in diameter, so the deeper you cut, the wider the lettering becomes. I've kept the finer lettering quite shallow to allow for this, but the volume, power and menu buttons have large markings on them so they can go a little deeper. Next up are the shoulder buttons. The design on these is fairly simple, so this will be a nice quick one. Again, I roughed the stock down with the 4mm end mill, machined the little tab out with the 2mm end mill, and then finished off the radiused edge with a 4mm bullnose cutter. The bottom edge of these also needs a bit of a radius, but since it's the only detail I can't reach from the top, I will just file a bit of a radius onto it by hand while I'm getting the buttons ready for polishing. And finally, last but not least, are the trigger buttons. These are quite a complex, fiddly little part that I will need to process from both sides. I decided to start with the outside since there is a nice flat section where I can apply some tape to hold them down when I flip them for side two. The process is basically the same as the previous two molds. A quick rough down with the 4mm end mill, and then all the radiused and tapered sections get finished off with the bullnose cutter. Then I'll flip it and get to work on the inside, which is where the real fun begins. I'll start off by roughing out the bulk of the material. I have to be careful not to cut past the edge of the parts as I'm relying on a thin layer of aluminium to provide support for the bulk of the machining operations so that I'm not only relying on the tape to hold the parts in place as I finish cutting them out. All of the work on this side is done by the same two tools. Once the roughing is finished, I can use the bullnose cutter to smooth out the tapered back side of the buttons and any of the radiused internal surfaces. There's a few little areas that I can't fully get the cutter into, but none of them are critical to the function of the parts, so that will have to do. Now that all the positives are finished, I'm going to give them a polish with my Dremel. The silicone actually picks up a staggering amount of detail, so if I polish the buttons to a shine first, the finished resin buttons will come out with a glossy smooth finish. I'm just using a little polishing wheel and polish that came with a cheap Dremel accessories kit, which seems to do a great job on these little parts. I did give them all a quick wet sand with some 400 grit sandpaper first to remove as many of the machining marks as possible, and then with a bit of 600 grit just to smooth off the surface prior to polishing. With all the positives polished, cleaned and looking nice and shiny, it's time to make some molds. I've got piles of scrap polycarbonate left over from work, so I'm going to use this to make the boxes for the molds. I'm just scoring the polycarb with a sharp knife and then snapping it on the score lines to cut it down to size. I'll then assemble the boxes with sticky tape on all the seams. I'm going to hold the aluminium positives down in the boxes with a dot or two of superglue to ensure they don't move when I pour in the silicone. The silicone I'm using for the molds is called Pinky Cell. It's a fast setting silicone with a 1-to-1 mix ratio and a nice quick half hour demold time. You do only get 6 minutes of working time with it, but that's usually plenty of time for these smaller molds. Mine is getting a little old, so it's a bit thicker than it normally is, but I think I can get away with it still. I'll try to be careful when mixing it so I don't introduce too many bubbles. I do have a little vacuum chamber, but with such a short pot life, there's not really enough time to properly degas the silicone. Most of the air bubbles in the molds I've done previously have come from air pockets formed due to surface tension when pouring the silicon, so that I've found that pouring the silicon in slowly in the areas with finer details first is the best way to avoid too many problems. Let's come back a bit later and see how they look.
3 hours later.
Enough time has passed, so let's take the molds out and see how they look. Looks like the only major bubble I got was in the slot that mounts the shoulder buttons, so I may have to have another go of mold for them, but I think everything else will work well, so let's get some resin into the molds and see what happens. I'm using some clear casting epoxy resin for the buttons. I've added some black resin dye along with a bit of black mica powder to give the buttons a nice shimmery black look. The resin I'm using has a nice long working time of 1 hour with a demold of roughly 24 hours, so I've got heaps of time to ensure it's well mixed and poured exactly where I want it. The mix is 2-to-1, so I've measured out about 20 mils of part A and 10 of part B off camera, so let's give them a mix and start pouring. Now that I've mixed everything well, I will pour the resin into the molds. I like to use a skewer to help guide the resin into the right places. I had another go at this later off camera and found that I could just scoop the resin up with the skewer and place it into the molds one drip at a time. It was a bit more time consuming, but I ended up with much less mess and a better filled molds as a result. I've done my best to level the molds with some folded bits of paper, as if they don't sit flat, the resin won't form a nice flat back for the buttons. It's important to fill the mold slowly to allow the resin time to fill in all the little details. I found if you pour it in too quickly, it will form bubbles towards the bottom of the molds and you won't know until you demold them. Now I just need to wait for the epoxy to set and I can have a look at the finished product. In the meantime, let's talk about the next revision of the PCBs.
I've spent a bunch of time since the last video getting the next revisions ready, as well as completely redesigning the right half of the controller and keycap. When I started this project, I was using Eagle for my PCB designs, but I ended up designing myself into a corner with the left controller PCBs, as they were a little too large for the free version of Eagle, so I had to swap to KiCad to keep going. Since I'm planning on releasing all the project files, I decided it was worth the hassle transferring the entire design over to KiCad. The first prototype of the power management system is now complete and currently being produced by PCBWay, along with the next revision of all of the controller boards, so I should have them soon to test for the next video. PCBWay are a sponsor of this channel and have helped make this project possible, so please check them out if you need any parts for this or any other projects made. Now, let's demold these buttons and see how they came out.
Looks like most of them came out pretty nicely. I have a small amount of work to do on the buttons now that I've finished casting them. There's a little bit of a gap at the bottom of the trigger buttons, but I can just sand that back and fill the remaining hole with resin by hand. The D-pad needs a little indent put in the back face to help locate it on its center pivot. The triggers also need a hole carefully drilled through them for the pivot pin. The hole would have made them very difficult to remove from the mold, so I decided it was easier to leave the hole out and add it in once the buttons were cast. I've created a little 3D printed jig to help with the alignment of this hole, as getting it in exactly the right spot is critical to the triggers working smoothly. The shoulder buttons aren't going to be any use due to the bubble in the silicon mold, but at least the outside of them looks good, so I'll give them another go later once I redo the silicon mold. The rest of the buttons just needed a quick clean up to remove any rough bits of resin around the edges, and now there's only one more step to complete before I can finally fit them up. That step is to make the molds for the silicon button membranes. These are optional, but they soften the tactile sound of the buttons as well as give the buttons a tiny bit more travel. I won't go into too much detail on the mold machining as the video is starting to get long. I machined these out of plastic as there's no need for these parts to be polished to a shine. The two halves of the mold slide together on the pin so I can clamp them in place tightly to squeeze out any excess silicon and ensure that the thickness of the finished parts is exactly the size I'm expecting it to be. Okay, now that we have a complete set of buttons and membranes, I'm going to go ahead and fit all these new parts off camera and give it a test again.
I've got the correct Hall effect sensors here now, along with the MPU 6050 module for the gyroscopic aim, so we can test it all out at the same time.
First up, here's a close-up look at the finished buttons. I'll do my best to record their sound, but they are nice and quiet and have a good feel to them now. They are very similar to the buttons on a Joy-Con in terms of feel.
I've also been able to calibrate up the triggers and get them recognised by the controller, and it looks like they are functioning properly with nice linear travel, so I will update the GitHub page to include the files to make them. I've also got the gyroscope module talking to the Pico. although working out how to actually use the sensor to achieve the feel I'm going for might take a bit of messing around, so that will have to wait till the next video. There's still a lot of work to do on the software side of things too, so that is going to be my focus anyway while I wait for the next batch of PCBs to arrive.
Sean Book over on the Discord asked about a couple of games that I hadn't tried yet, so I decided to test a couple of them out for him. I've got the power monitor hooked up too for a runtime estimate. This is Fallout New Vegas. The launcher picked ultra settings for me automatically on the first startup, so I'll run with that for now. I'm running at 1280 by 720, since the resolution options this game gives me are fairly limited. The display driver seems to do a decent job at scaling down the content to the native resolution when required. The game itself is running pretty smoothly with no major issues found so far. I hadn't played this particular Fallout game prior to this video, but I'm enjoying it so far. I'll have to add it to the backlog of games I've got building up that I need to spend some more time on. For these older Games for Windows titles, the only controller support is with an Xbox controller, so I'm running a piece of software called X360CE, which takes the controller inputs and emulates an Xbox 360 controller. I'll chuck a link to the software in the video description. This game with these settings seems to average about 43 watts of power draw, so we should see about an hour 20 runtime on this one. I'll have to do some experiments and see if the power draw drops considerably with lower graphics settings, as that may be a good way to squeeze out a little bit more battery life. Let's move on to Skyrim. This is another one of those massively popular games I've heard plenty of people talk about, but I completely missed the bandwagon on it when it was first released back in 2011. This game also picked ultra settings automatically, although I think it should probably be lowered a little as it doesn't feel quite as responsive as I would like. It could be because I'm having to run this one in borderless windowed mode due to what I think is a bug with the NUC's GPU driver, which causes it to not output audio over HDMI when some programs run in full screen mode. As far as I can tell, it only affects the 7th generation NUCs, and there is probably an older driver that doesn't have this issue, so I'll have to try a few of them out to confirm. This does only affect the speakers and the headphone jacks, so if you're going to use Bluetooth headphones, you probably won't have any trouble. This game is running at about the same power consumption as the last one, so you can expect about an hour 20 out of it too. Now that the controls are fully finished, the only major thing I have left to complete now is the power management, which I'll be looking at in the next video. As this project is getting very close to being complete now, I'll be diving into some new projects very soon, so make sure you stick around to see what I have planned. I'll continue working on the software and the finishing touches for the NucDeck 2, so don't worry, I will still finish everything off while I'm working on the next project. The Discord is really starting to get busy now, and there's plenty of people over there working on their own projects, so if you enjoy this sort of thing or want advice on your projects, feel free to join up and check it out.
The channel has also just hit 2,000 subscribers, so thank you to everyone who hit that button. I appreciate you all. See you in the next one.